For those of you that don't know me, my name is Courtney, and I'm a PhD candidate working with Pete Lipper at the University of Utah. And I spend a lot of my time looking for magnetic needles in marine haystacks, aka magnetofossils. So that's what I'll be talking about tonight. Specifically, I'll be presenting work from two of our papers, the first of which is recently resubmitted to PMP. And then the second is in press and under embargo with PNAS. This work wouldn't be possible without the large collaborative effort between my co-authors, especially Nono, Ramon, and Pete. So big shout out to those guys. And then, of course, the various sources of funding listed here that have supported our work. So I also want to note, I've numbered the slides in the upper right here. So if you have specific questions, feel free to use those slide numbers to reference them. All right, so without further ado, let's talk about magnetofossils. So real quick, what are they and why are they important? So they are the remains of iron biomineralizing organisms, including magnetotactic bacteria. And due to the stable single domain nature of most magnetofossils, they can contribute a large proportion to the natural remnant magnetization of sediments. And because of the environmental sensitivity of most magnetofossils, they can be used, or the iron biomineralizing organisms that make them, they can be used to study environmental change. So generally, there are two categories of magnetofossils, the first of which is on the left here. These are conventional magnetofossils. These are the ones we most often refer to. They're the fossil remains of magnetotactic bacteria. So they're super small. They're about 50 nanometers in size. And we usually refer to them through the biogenic soft and biogenic hard coercivity components in bulk sediments. And this is a lot of work that's been pioneered mostly by Ramon Egli. And then on the right-hand side, we have the other category, which are giant magnetofossils. And per their name, they are much larger than conventional magnetofossils. Most of them are larger than 1 micron in size. And unlike conventional magnetofossils, we have so far only found them in Eocene hyperthermal events, so we have no modern analog for them. But because of that, we think that they might be related to some of the environmental perturbations that are associated with these events. But one of the outstanding questions about giant magnetofossils is, do they have a magnetic fingerprint so that we can more easily find them in bulk sediments and see what kind of environmental change they can tell us about? So this brings us to the first question we'll be answering tonight, or this afternoon, wherever you are, do giant magnetofossils have any sort of magnetic fingerprint that can help us identify them more easily without non-destructive techniques? The second question, if they do have a magnetic signature, can we quantify differences in magnetofossil disparity, so changes in the relative morphospace or shapes and sizes of magnetofossils using magnetic measurements? And then from that, our third question, do changes in magnetofossil disparity record environmental change? So to answer these questions, we look to the Paleocene-Eocene Thermal Maximum, or PETM for short. And on the bottom left here is about 68 million years ago, and on the bottom right is present day. On the y-axis over here, on the left, we have benthic, oxygen isotopes from benthic foraminifera. And essentially what we end up with from this isotope curve is a relative temperature curve over the Cenozoic. And you'll notice I've highlighted by the red box here, the PETM at around 56 million years ago. And it's this relatively instantaneous warming event. So it's a good analog for modern climate change. Some of the environmental changes we see that happen during the PETM that are relevant to our study are increased sea surface and bottom water temperature, seasonal runoff, and faunal turnover. So we are using PETM samples from Wilson Lake, New Jersey, which is highlighted by the yellow star here. And in the top panel, we can see that the southern half of New Jersey was actually underwater during the PETM 56 million years ago. And then in the cross section below, we see Wilson Lake again as this yellow star. So we see that it is approximately 70 meters water depth, making it a continental shelf environment. Here's the stratigraphy of Wilson Lake. So I've highlighted the PETM with this pale pink background here. And the onset or the start of the PETM is highlighted by this red dashed line right here. And then the PETM at Wilson Lake is cut off by an unconformity at the top of the core, and that's this lower squiggly line right here. And coincident with a PETM at Wilson Lake and around the globe is this negative carbon isotope excursion. So we see that in the stable carbon isotopes from foraminifera, benthic foraminifera right here. And then also coincident with the onset of the PETM at Wilson Lake is this stepwise increase in bulk magnetic parameters. So here I'm showing magnetic squareness. And previous studies have done a really good job characterizing these bulk magnetic properties. And they have attributed them to large abundances of magnetofossils. So that makes Wilson Lake ideal for our environmental magnetism study to see if we can tease apart these magnetofossil signatures using magnetic measurements. Another reason why Wilson Lake is ideal for our study is because the litho, chemo, and biostratigraphy are also all well characterized. So in order to characterize the magnetofossils at Wilson Lake, we're using first order reversal curve diagrams, which Andrew introduced to us earlier this evening. And here's an example of one of our fork diagrams where we have coercivity on the x-axis, magnetic interaction on the y-axis, and then in the far right over here, we have fork signal or amplitude, where the warmer colors are larger signal and the cooler colors are lower signal. And because fork data sets are sensitive to the magnetization state of different magnetic assemblages within a bulk sediment sample, and as Andrew told us earlier, they can be used to differentiate between different populations of magnetic particles in a bulk sediment. So here we're using them to characterize different populations of magnetofossils. So one of the most distinguishing features of magnetofossils is this central ridge feature, or this distinct ridge-like feature at where approximately where BU equals zero. And it's usually accompanied by this negative region in the lower left of the fork diagram. And in sediments like ours, at least, this can be a fingerprint of magnetofossils. We can take it a step further and do basically a cross-section across the central ridge feature. And that's what this red line is down here. And this is a coercivity distribution across the central ridge. And we'll notice right away that there's this clear contribution to the central ridge over the range for conventional magnetofossils from about 10 to 120 millitesla. But interestingly, there's also this high coercivity component to the central ridge. And so when we saw this at first, we were unsure if this was real or not, what it could be related to. So we wanted to answer this question, figure it out. So we pulled in the big guns, and specifically we did extensive fork measurements using an optimized protocol that's specific to the Lakeshore 8600 VSM. And this protocol takes advantage of the exceptional field control of this instrument. And we also improved the signal to noise of our measurements by stacking 32 of them. So just for fun, I think this fork diagram, we estimated took about 88 measurement days. Oof. So off the bat, we were really happy to see that the central ridges or the central ridge in this diagram was also very distinct. And we could verify that this high coercivity component was real as well. And since our measurements were so high resolution, we could also make out some of these additional features. So real quickly, we have the single domain rotation signature, which is this positive negative doublet and fork amplitude in the lower left here, flux closure annihilation termination signatures in the top center of the fork diagram. And then we have single domain rotation termination features in the center right of the fork diagram right here. And notably, there's these high coercivity contributions right here. The exceptional signal to noise ratio of our measurements allowed us to look at the central ridge in greater detail as well. So that's what I'm showing here in the top right. This is a zoom in of the central ridge and with vertical exaggeration. And so BU I've highlighted by this bold black line, and the actual vertical offset of the central ridge is highlighted by this dashed line here above the black line. And we see over the range for conventional magnetofossils, kind of the classic 0.4 millitesla offset. But then once we get to this higher coercivity component, there's this additional 0.7 millitesla offset. So what we're seeing here is we have these additional signatures that seem to be characteristic of magnetofossils, but they're outside the range for conventional magnetofossils. So We hypothesized that these are related to giant needle-shaped magnetofossils. Why giant needles, you might be asking yourself. If you're not, that's okay too. But in short, these were the only other particles that we observed in magnetic extracts that are predicted to have single domain behavior besides conventional magnetofossils. So I've included here a Butler-Banerjee diagram, and where we have the single domain limits for individual particles highlighted by these dashed lines here. And so in this circle up here, the triangles are giant needles. And again, we could see that they're the only particles that are predicted to be single domain that are not conventional magnetofossils. So in addition to these extensive low noise work measurements, we verified that these signatures are associated with giant needles by comparing them to well-studied lake sediments and also micromagnetic simulations of needles that we observed in magnetic extracts. So here's our comparison to the well-studied lake sample. On the left is Wilson Lake, and I realized when I was looking at this slide yesterday that it could be a little misleading because Wilson Lake, but it's actually the marine PETM sample, so just remember that. Sorry if it's a little confusing. But on the right-hand side is the actual lake sample, BAL13, and this is from a lake in Switzerland. And I've highlighted at 120 millitesla this red dashed line here. And what I want you to take away from this slide is that in the modern lake sample, where the biogenic soft and biogenic hard coercivity components are well described by Ramon Egli, is that all of these magnetofossil signatures kind of disappear at 120 millitesla or by then. But in the fork diagram on the left from Wilson Lake, the PETM sample, we still have these high coercivity signatures. All right, so here again is that close-up of the central ridge from the Wilson Lake fork diagram. And in the bottom panel, we have delta BU, and this is calculated from the observed offset between BU equals zero and this dashed line here. And so in this bottom panel, BAL13 is highlighted in, by this red curve, and Wilson Lake is highlighted by this gray curve. And since BAL13 does not have signatures past 120 millitesla, we couldn't calculate anything past there. But we see this additional vertical offset produced by giant needles really well, reaching again 0.7 millitesla. We also see the single domain rotation termination and this additional contribution from another high coercivity component here. So again, we also verified the needle component with micromagnetic simulations. Here's a transmission electron microscopy image of a giant needle showing that the particle lengths are on average about 1 micron. So we used that as well as the overall rod-like morphology to constrain our simulations. And then we did simulations with varying needle widths, including 21, 25, 50, and 100 nanometers. And we also applied various magnetic field angles to the particle elongation from 0 to 90 degrees. So here I'll be showing you just one of the many simulations that Nono did. These are the resulting hysteresis loops for applied field angle of 30 degrees. And it might be a little tough for you to see, so I'm just gonna point this out, but the green and yellow curves on the outside correspond to the thinnest needles, the 21 and 25 nanometer needles. And this red curve in the middle corresponds to the 100 nanometer wide needle. So off the bat, we see this sort of relationship between increasing coercivity and decreasing needle width. And so these are results from just the 50 nanometer wide needle with the applied field of 30 degrees. And what you can see between the static images and this beautiful GIF that Nono made is that between about 45 and 100 millitesla switching field, we start to see curling at the needle extremities, and then by 105 millitesla, it switches. So again, Nono actually did a ton of simulations. So this is a summary figure, just kind of putting it all together. And we're not gonna spend a lot of time here, so I'll just go over this a little quickly, but on the far right, we have coercivity and switching field in millitesla. And then on the left, we have the normalized values. On the bottom, we have the applied field angle. And all these different symbols correspond to the different needle widths. And the closed symbols are coercivity. The open symbols are switching field. And what I want you to take away from this slide in particular is that there's these beautiful relationships between coercivity and switching field with needle width. So specifically, as needle width increases, these values decrease. So if you didn't get any of that, here's a summary of our simulations. We found that individual needles have a single domain remnants and coercivities and switching fields that vary between 100 to 300 millitesla. And there's this relationship between these values and needle width. All right, so in summary, we're really excited to report that the biogenic needle component can be teased out of these low noise fork diagrams. And this component is best described by coercivities that range between 120 to 300 millitesla. They have single domain remnants characteristics, and they also have this additional vertical offset to the central ridge of about 0.7 millitesla. And so finally, we conclude that this biogenic needle component is actually a fingerprint of giant needle shaped magnetofossils. So this brings us back to our questions. We answered yes to this first one. So now we can dive into the next one, which is again, can we quantify magnetofossil disparity, which is the change in the morpho space of magnetofossils using magnetic measurements? So to answer this, let's go back to our original fork diagram where we observed these two relative ranges over the central ridge coercivity distribution, where the first one was conventional magnetofossils, and now we know the second one can be attributed to giant needles. Now let's look at changes in these signatures throughout the PETM. So here I'm showing you two additional fork diagrams. We actually measured 65 different intervals, but just to kind of give you an idea of how they change with the stratigraphy, we have this one that represents samples from the bottom of the core, the beginning of the PETM. This one's from roughly in the middle, and this one's from the top, just before that unconformity. And what you'll notice is that all three of these have a distinct central ridge. Awesome. But you also might notice that the coercivity distributions are all a little different. So just to point out a couple of differences, the fork diagrams on the bottom and the top have these wider coercivity distributions, but the one in the middle has this more narrow distribution. So this is suggesting off the get-go that there are changes in within magnetofossil populations throughout the PETM. So after observing these changes, our next question was whether these changes are actually real or whether there is something else like magnetofossil taphonomy. So specifically, we're wondering if we can quantify these changes in the coercivity distributions and whether they represent magnetofossil disparity. So to answer these questions, we performed fork PCA principal component analysis on those 65 first order reversal curve data sets from throughout the PETM. You can see in the bottom left here, in this plot, the P-score plot, that we have each of our samples, they're color-coded from bottom of the core to top of the core, from white to black. And in our PCA, principal component one explained about 66% of the variability in our data, and PC2 explained about 17% of the variability. In the top of the slide, we have our simulated N members. You can see where they fall on the PCA score plot. And you'll notice that each of these N members also have distinct central ridge features. And so we can also look at the coercivity distributions across these central ridges, which is what this plot is here in the top right. So let's take a closer look at each of the N members. We'll start with N member two. We see the coercivity distribution for this N member is really narrow. It's actually kind of similar to the fork diagram from the middle of the PETM, and it has a peak coercivity peak in the distribution of about 25 millitesla. So this actually kind of reminds us of the biogenic soft component. And then we have M number three highlighted in green. This N number has a peak in the distribution of about 40 millitesla. Reminds us of the biogenic hard component. And then M number one highlighted in purple has the widest coercivity distribution with a peak around 65 millitesla. And notably, this distribution extends well beyond the range for conventional magnetofossils, which is again 120 millitesla. So we think that this M number is diagnostic of the biogenic needle component. And so in summary, we have these M members with striking similarity to magnetofossil components, and we have the relative proportions for each of these M members. And so that's what I'm showing here in this ternary diagram, that we have these proportions throughout the stratigraphy. So that means we can actually look at it with the stratigraphy and see if there's any correlation to environmental change. And so for example, we have M member one first here that has this peak at the beginning of the PETM and then just before that first unconformity. Next, we have M member two. It's got this wider peak that occurs just after that peak in M number one. And M number three has two peaks in the lower half of the PETM, but then this stepwise increase for the second half of the PETM. And so now that we can tell that we actually can quantify these changes in the coercivity distributions across the central ridges, our next question is naturally just, what are these M members? So one way we can figure this out and answer this question is using transmission electron microscopy imaging of magnetic extracts. So we targeted intervals with different proportions of these M members. All right, here's a quick and dirty summary of our TEM results. We did not find any giant magnetofossils in the intervals that had less than 5% of N number one, which again, we think is linked to the bidirectional needle component. However, we did find giant, we did find giant magnetofossils in the interval that had greater than 70% of N number one. Notably, there were giant needle-shaped magnetofossils, which we know now is correlated to the biogenic needle component. And so from this, we see this correlation between M number one proportions and giant magnetofossils, particularly the giant needle-shaped magnetofossils. So this is my face when I find a giant needle. But as a quick summary, we found that intervals that have the largest proportions of M number one also had giant magnetofossils. And because the coercivity distributions for the other N members are fairly uniform and correspond to these different magnetofossil components, we interpret N number one to signal or be sensitive to the biogenic needle component, N number two, biogenic soft component, and N number three, the biogenic hard component. So going back to our questions again, we answered yes to the second question by showing that for PCA can to an extent distinguish between magnetofossil disparity being changes in the relative proportions of biogenic soft, hard, and needles. And so now for our last question, does magnetofossil disparity record environmental change? So to start answering these questions, we can start again with our simulated M numbers and see what they might mean. So starting with M number two, again, we interpret this M number to be sensitive to the biogenic soft component. And in modern studies, biogenic soft magnetofossils have been associated with one of two things, either oligotrophic environments or stratified estuaries. So because M number two correlates to stress-tolerant benthic foraminifera biogroups, we are running with the latter interpretation that both M number two, biogenic soft magnetofossils and these foraminifera suggest stratification of the water column. Similarly, with M number three, in the modern, most biogenic hard magnetofossils are associated with nutrients and seasonal eutrophication. And M number three here also correlates to benthic foraminifera that indicate seasonal nutrient cycling as well. So we interpret M number three proportions as intervals that are dominated by seasonality. And lastly, M number one in the bottom left here, this M number, again, we interpret is sensitive to the biogenic needle component. And because of this, we think it might also fingerprint other giant magnetofossils. And since giant magnetofossils have only been found during Eocene hyperthermals, we think that they're associated with some of the more extreme changes in the environment that happen during these time periods. So some of those would be increased weathering leading to increased iron supply and expansion of the oxic-anoxic interface. So I know I went through these a little quickly. Feel free to ask me more about these after, but in summary, we are really excited because Fork PCA can distinguish between environmentally sensitive populations of magnetofossils. I do also wanna note that these interpretations are based on just a few studies in the modern. So we definitely need more of those modern studies to link these magnetofossil components to specific environmental conditions, but still exciting. All right, so now we answered yes to our last question and yes to all of our questions, so we can apply our findings in more detail. So given our proposed associations between our four PCIM members and environmental change, we hypothesize that the large abundance of magnetofossils that we see at Wilson Lake is mainly driven by expansion of the oxic-anoxic interface, or the OAI. So to show you kind of what we mean, on the left-hand side is where we have a more narrow OAI, or where it's maybe pushed down into the sediment more. And so in this kind of N-member scenario, we have more conventional magnetofossils with respect to giants. But on the right-hand side, during an expanded OAI, we interpret this as actually like an expanded niche, ecological niche. So we might have more giant magnetofossils with respect to conventional magnetofossils. And we think that the changes in the OAI itself might be related to changes in climate, nutrient supply, and precipitation across the New Jersey shelf. Here's a cartoon summary of those interpretations so that we can look at them with a stratigraphy. So I've redrawn the bulk carbon isotopes as well as M-member 1 proportions. And behind them, I've also highlighted our interpretation of the relative thickness of the OAI. So there are peaks in both of these data sets respectively. We interpret these intervals as like the thickest OAI. So that's that darker gray in the background. And we also think that the largest proportions of giant needles, or M-member 1, were dependent on large amounts of iron. So where there are relative peaks in M-member 1, we loosely interpret these as weathering events that led to increased iron supply. Here's M-member 2 redrawn. And again, we think this M-member is sensitive to the biogenic soft component and therefore long-term stratification. So this is highlighted in the medium gray background down here in the bottom right. And then we have M-member 3 on the far right here. And this M-member we think is sensitive to the biogenic hard component, and therefore we interpret it large proportions of M-member 3 as intervals dominated by seasonal eutrophication. And then overall, these data are telling us that there were changes in the OAI and nutrient supply that led to the abundant magnetofossils and the high disparity of magnetofossils that we see here. And all of this agrees with previous studies, including changes in benthic foraminifera, which is really great. And then just to mention again, more work is needed to iron out these relationships, but what we are showing is exciting and promising for the future of 4PCA. 4PCA itself is an overall very promising tool for quantifying magnetofossil disparity and environmental change. And it worked really well here at Wilson Lake. And we think that it'll also work well in magnetofossil-rich intervals throughout geologic time. So I have three main takeaways to leave you with that'll help you with your search for biogenic needles in marine haystacks. The first takeaway is that the biogenic needle component does fingerprint giant needle-shaped magnetofossils in bulk sediments. The second is that 4PCA is sensitive to magnetofossil disparity, or relative magnetofossil disparity, marked by the biogenic soft, biogenic hard, and biogenic needle components. And then the third is that 4PCA can be used to understand environmental change. And again, we think it worked really well here, Wilson Lake, and it'll probably work well, especially with advances on more machine learning and other intervals like those that I list here. So thank you very much. Take any questions.
So thank you, Courtney. That was really, really fantastic. It's really see what's become of this.
Thank you. Hopefully I kept kind of awake.
And Andrew can wake up now too. Or come off the ceiling. I think he was quite excited. So I want to point out that there is a way to put these kinds of results, like your EM123 percentages, yeah, oxygen isotopes, for example, just as examples, we've put into the MAGIC database another column in the table, and it's called external results.
Okay.
Put anything in there. I just put in a bunch of Delta C13 data, you know.
Right.
So you can put it in there, and we just need a method code that describes exactly what that is. But so in a compact way, you can put these data right in there with your magnetics data, which makes it easier to use. You know, you've got the same depth and everything.
Yeah.
Metadata already there for the age control, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm excited that that do that. And then there's a place for these data, because where else are you going to put them?
I was having that issue, and I am really excited that you say that, because I had emailed Nick back and forth a little while, like a few months ago, back when we were submitting these manuscripts. I don't think that existed at that point. So I'm super excited to hear about that now for future.
Do that, Nick. I think it was like, well, just for I guess it's a paleoceanography paper that I published. Okay. I needed it because I had all these oxygenized, you know, all these
different
data that went along with the magstrat data, and I needed a place to put it. And a lot of it comes from your buddy, buddy there, Turi Serling. So.
Oh yeah, Turi.
Saved his data.
Cool. Thank you. What was that?
It's magic. So.
Seriously, no, that's really great.
So work with Nick or me, call us, email us, whatever.
Definitely. Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else have anything?
It looked like there was some stuff maybe in the chat. I'm trying to.
Sonia Tiku had a question.
Okay. Yeah. Do you always have to stack this question? Right? Do you always have to stack so many forks to resolve the high coercivity ridge? So super good question. For the vertical offset, yes. Otherwise, we actually have here, let me show you. So you all can still see these slides over here, right?
Mm-hmm.
Good. I thought I put this in here. Here it is. Yeah. So we actually did some lower resolution measurements to see if we could do the same thing. And these are also stacked fork diagrams. And to answer your question shortly, you need these really extensive measurements to basically prove, and I don't like using that word, but to like put your finger on it that they're actually there and that the offset is real. But even with these lower resolution measurements, you can still see the kind of bare bones signatures related to giant needles, which is that high coercivity, distinct central ridge just in the standard fork diagram. So yeah, I hope that answered your question. To actually confirm that there are giant needles, you'd probably need to do magnetic extracts and do the extensive measurements. But if you have a really well-constrained lithology and some other supporting evidence, maybe just this would be enough.
So Sonia followed up saying, Do you see this as a screening tool, or is it faster to just go straight to TEM?
Ooh, yeah. So,
because it ain't fast.
Yeah, definitely. If you're looking for just like the super verification, TEM. But if you have that other supporting evidence. These lower resolution measurements, each one of those only takes about 10 hours instead. So,
Then Julie Bowles had a question. Did you do the forks on bulk sediments, or did you do them on?
Also a really good question. And one of the reasons why we're super excited about this is because the needle signature is seen on bulk sediments. So we did not do the fork measurements on magnetic extracts. They were actual bulk sediments. And the super, super high resolution forks that Ramon did was on a powdered sample, but these lower resolution measurements were on an intact sediment chip. So both of them are technically in situ measurements, but we took it a step further and showed that it is still distinguishable in the intact sediment chips.
And then Andrew had says nice talk, and says that most people will not need to or want to do a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
Not be detected by most people. I'm glad that you did this, but the exceptionally high coercivity in this case is diagnostic. And that's something that I wanted to ask you about, because it seems to me that what you have is something that's diagnostic of needles. And those may or may not be biogenic, as Andrew knows, and Jeff Gee, people who work with the silicates, you can have exalt needles in there. And I think you'll find those too. You'll find, and if you have silicates in your sediments, you could find them this way as well.
And for sure.
Not confuse them with magnetofossils, because they're igneous.
So that's actually, that's a really good thing to keep in mind too, because actually one of our reviewers brought this up as well, that the biogenic needle component, this high coercivity central ridge signature, by itself, just like in these fork diagrams, isn't unique to the giant needles, and the exsolved needles and silicates and stuff like that can produce similar high coercivity contributions to the central ridge. So when I was mentioning, like, you need to have a good idea of your lithology, like ours are marine sediments. We know there's no igneous influence, and we have a good constraint from previous studies on just like what's in there. So we know that it can't be those other sources. So you gotta keep that in mind, unfortunately. But...
yeah, I wonder. Okay, so anybody have any other questions? Because we have two more minutes.